Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of Christ.
And the young man said, "But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he's going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. To quote a young Methodist preacher that I saw recently, "This is no way to run a resurrection. This is no way to run a resurrection. First, because in Mark's account of the resurrection, in what many believe is the end of the gospel itself, at the end, then, there are no sightings of Jesus at all. No stories about Jesus appearing to the disciples in a tucked-away upper room. No stories about Jesus encouraging Thomas to touch his wounds. No stories about Jesus appearing to the disciples along the road. No stories about Jesus appearing on the shore as the disciples went back to their fishing. In other words, Mark includes nothing concrete, nothing palpable, no sightings of Jesus to reassure us that Jesus was risen from the dead at all. But that's not all. That's not the only reason we might believe that Mark didn't know how to run a resurrection. For there's the matter of the women in Mark's story. The women who visit the tomb in the early morning to care for Jesus' body, something they would have done out of love for him. As in some of the other gospel accounts, the women don't find the body of their dead friend, but instead encounter a messenger of sorts who tells them that Jesus is risen and is going before them to Galilee as he had told them he would. The same messenger then tells them that they are to go and tell others the news that Jesus has been raised from the dead. But in Mark, and only in the Gospel of Mark, the women do not do this. Instead, they are seized by two powerful things. Traumas, which literally means trembling, but which some commentators connect to the word in Greek for the experience of trauma or wounding, and ecstasis, that is, ecstasy, being beside themselves in a kind of wordless wonder. Overwhelmed by a kind of trembling trauma, And so as the young Methodist preacher said, this is no way to run a resurrection. Because Mark does not tie his story up with a big shiny bow, ending it with the women shouting the news of the resurrection as they run from the tomb to deliver the same glad news to the other disciples and friends. This is no way to run a resurrection, because here we are, some of us in our best or maybe better Easter clothes, ready to bring an end to trembling trauma, to fear, ready to embark upon our own Easter journey, ready to break our Lenten, our Good Friday's feastlessness, ready ourselves to say out loud that Jesus is risen. So what was Mark thinking to end his gospel in this way? Is this just kind of an ancient fumble? What is it? And what are we to make of it on this day of all days, and at this time, when more and more we may need to break our own silences and to speak in new and courageous ways in our lives, in our society, in the world? To get at this, let's go back just for a minute to what Mark actually tells us. Mark tells us first that the women were trembling. And some would suggest, at least in part, from some kind of experience of trauma. If this is so, one way of conceiving of this is not just that it was traumatic to hear that Jesus was risen, because surely it was traumatic to hear this, but that the women brought their own experience of trauma with them into the tomb. They brought it with them. That trauma would have come from being the ones who witnessed Jesus' brutal crucifixion at the hands of the Romans. For as Mark tells him, Jesus was deserted by all of his more official disciples and friends, and only the women witnessed his crucifixion, Mark says, from afar, so they were standing away from where the action was. This, of course, would have been traumatic for them. Not only because they, too, had hoped for a different kind of Messiah, one that would be adored and not be crucified, but also it would have been traumatic for them because Jesus' crucifixion would have triggered them, would have triggered their own sense of vulnerability, not only as Jewish persons, but as Jewish women, under the violent and capricious thumb of Roman occupiers. We don't just have to have the trauma. When we see it, it triggers us with who we are, about who we are, what we've already experienced, what we probably will experience again. Those who study trauma say this, that silence is the language of trauma. Speechlessness is the way that trauma expresses itself, for there just aren't words to describe the kind of shock it is to the system, for instance, to survive a terrible car accident, to watch someone you love die, even bit by bit, to absorb a terrible injustice that comes your way or comes to the people you love and would hope to protect. Silence is the language of trauma. But a kind of trembling trauma isn't the only source of the women's silence. So here's the other part. Their silence also has to do with their ecstasy. Ecstasy, a word meant to point to the indescribable and wordless experience that can come upon us when we're told something so unbelievable and so potentially liberating that we have no reference for it in our experience. We don't have any word to attach to it. For the women, this would have been the news that Jesus, their beloved, the one whom they saw violently killed, was not dead, but had risen and had been released somehow into the world in a new way ahead of them. But their ecstasy would not just have been about him. For Jesus' resurrection from the dead would also have meant that their subjugation as Jewish persons and as Jewish women, that subjugation was over. And finally, for them, Jesus' resurrection would have meant that life itself was no longer predictably tied up with one big, dark, sad bow, the eventuality and finality of death. The one thing we think we can depend on, gone. And so when you think about it, Mark's ending with the women fearfully rushing from the tomb, made speechless by their trembling trauma and by ecstasy, makes perfect sense. For why would the women do anything else at that time? I say at that time because, of course, Mark's audience, those that the gospel was written for, Mark's audience would have known that someone eventually said something about the resurrection, for there they were, Christians themselves, living in the light of the risen Christ. I also say at that time, for silence in the face of trembling trauma, silence in the face of ecstasy, eventually finds a voice. Sometimes it takes a very long time. And sometimes it's not just our voice, it's the voice of those who come after us. Sometimes we're lucky enough that it is our voice. For look, Indigenous peoples in Canada, silent for years about what they suffered in residential school, found their voice and have become silent no more. Japanese Canadians, silent for years about losing everything and going into the internment camps, found their voice and have become and are becoming silent no more. Veterans of World War II, silent for years about what they have seen and what they had to do, found their voice and are becoming silent no more. Women all over the world, silent for years about harassment and assault on account of just being women, have found their voice and are becoming silent no more. And young people and their parents in the United States, silent for years in the face of the trauma of gun violence in their schools and in their neighborhoods, have found their voice and are becoming silent no more. So today, this very day, is not about our gospel tying up everything with a big shiny bow so that we can sit back in our chairs satisfied with the way Mark has told the story, in the same way we might push back our chairs from the table after a wonderfully filling Easter dinner, you know, that feeling. No, today is about giving thanks for the women who survived their trembling trauma and who were vessels of ecstasy, who give us a chance to say out loud that subjugation and death will not have the last word in this world of ours and in our lives. We, then, are the ones who finish Mark's story. We are the ones who get to do what the women could not do at that time as they rushed speechless from the tomb. We get to break the back of the many traumas that have silenced us and silenced others through speaking up about them. We get to taste the ecstasy of telling the story of how hard life can be, and yet in the face of these hardships, how the oppressed can go free, how the brokenhearted can be made whole, and how the dead can live again. And so, as you remember, and maybe you're remembering right now, those places in your life or in your community where silence reigns on account of the trauma beneath it, as you remember those things you believe you cannot speak up about or those people you believe you cannot speak up to, remember this. Christ is risen. And in his rising, you and I have been inaugurated anew into the truth of our lives, and into the voicing of that truth, as messy as it might be. Christ is risen, and you and I have become messengers to the world that life, not death, will be the final word.